Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the God's Gifts to Develop My Loving Self question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentation, God's Gifts to Develop My Loving Self. Recorded on the 27th of May, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay. Last chance today to ask some questions about the subject at hand. So God's Gifts to Develop My Loving Self, Q&A, is the subject of our discussion now. Fire away, peoples. You want to start, Deirdre? You had your hand up before I even said anything. And Talia can on this side, thanks. So let's start with Deirdre.
I've been waiting about 5 years to ask this question.
Okay.
You've got here, in the relationship with God is only possible from my real self.
Yeah.
And I must develop my will to love sufficiently to desire. Sorry, I've got my glasses on. To desire my real self before I can connect to God.
Yep.
Same with truth.
Yep.
What effect does praying to God for God's love have on your soul when you have no connection with God?
Well, remember, prayer has to be an actual feeling, an actual desire in the soul. So the reality is, if you're just praying and you're just using your mind, you're not really using your soul to pray anyway. So of course you're not going to receive love under those circumstances. But the reality also is, even though we might be full of sin, we can also have a pure desire that begins in our real self for God, and in that moment receive some of God's love. So it just depends on whether the prayer is an actual real desire coming from the heart, or whether it's just an intellectual concept of I'll try that, or you know, whether it's not feeling based. So if it's not feeling based, then of course you're not going to receive anything. But if it's feeling based, you will always receive something.
Because I know I have been very emotional, like about 5 years ago when I did it, and I was just bawling my eyes out for hours and hours and hours.
Yeah.
But I don't know if I've received any of God's love, so it can be just emotional with even asking. Or
most people, when they pray to God and they do it from their heart, if you do it from your heart and you receive some of God's love, you will definitely be crying. In fact, you won't receive love unless you are, probably. So I'd suggest that event, certainly receive some. However, what did it do to you?
I had no physical pain whatsoever.
Correct.
I did it for about 3 or 4 months after the Open to God workshop.
Yeah.
And I got back into painting again.
So you connected with some of your real self, passions. Yeah.
And I was like, I had a little feeling that it wasn't like God had forgotten me, but I had forgotten me.
Yes. Yep, which is part of that process, yeah. Which is really the case, isn't it? Because the facade's all about forgetting the real self, so.
I was just feeling how badly I treated my brothers.
Yep, so you started to enter a state of some repentance. All of these are signs that you received some and it opened your heart. However, there's one other thing that happened too.
Yeah, I got told I was delusional.
Yeah.
And I stopped.
Correct.
That. Yeah.
Yeah, and since then you haven't done it.
No.
Just one, you know, this is where just somebody even just telling us something can affect us, can't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what we've got to do is make sure what I would do under those circumstances, I'd look at what happened to me. Yes, there's certain changes that happened. I've become more sensitive emotionally. I also became repentant about some things that I wasn't repentant about before. I started connecting to my real self. All of these things are signs that you receive some love, right? But it also showed you in that moment how focused you were on getting somebody else's approval for it to continue. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah, as a woman, so funnily enough.
And that shows you how much you or desperate you are for a woman's approval.
Yeah.
You're willing to close down any connection with God just to get the woman's approval. Does that make sense? And the woman may have mistakenly said it, or it may have even just been spirit influenced in the moment to say it, just to get you off your game even. It doesn't really matter what the motivation was.
Mm-hmm.
It shows you your addiction to have the approval of others to do it.
Yeah.
And God there is showing you the very next thing you need to work on.
Yeah, I didn't even think of it then.
Yeah. Very next thing.
Thank you.
Wonderful, huh? Yep. If we go to Eloisa on this side here, straight back. Thanks, Mel.
I had a memory about...
hold that mic closer, Eloisa.
Yeah, I have a memory of being very mean to a boy. Actually, I attacked him. I was 6 years old.
Yeah.
And he was about 6 years old as well.
Yeah.
And I hurt him so badly. I put him on the ground and hurt him. And then when I start feeling that hurt, I start feeling remorseful for that. And then I just want to ask if that feeling of remorse and pain that I inflicted in him was I felt in my real self.
Yeah, of course. Well, it's part of the pain that you've created for yourself. When we hurt another person, we create pain for ourselves, and a part of the feeling of remorse is processing the pain that we previously created for ourselves. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Through the act of hurting another. So you could say that it's the desire for repentance comes from the real self, but the actual feeling of the pain was this was releasing some pain about the pain you actually caused.
Yes, it's true, because I had this pain in my right leg for a long time, and now it's a bit less now.
Yeah. And that's what happens. Different pains in our body are the result of, generally, result of...
Our sin.
Our sin, yeah. Our sin. Interesting.
Yes. Sorry, for me it was insightful, and then I start feeling okay. Now I know how to go and just follow what you're showing me.
Yes.
About the terror of feeling.
Yeah.
The pain in the
result. But it is a single event, wasn't it? It was just a single event emotion.
Yeah.
And this is the thing: is that initially, generally, we feel single event emotions because they're easier. They're easier to deal with. So one event where we hurt somebody is usually a lot easier to deal with than hundreds of times we hurt somebody. Does that make sense?
Yes. Another thing, can I say it? When that happened to this boy, I remember even his name and himself. His father came to my house to complain to my mother. And my mother, instead of saying to me that was wrong, she said he provoked, he started. She actually say, okay, it's okay to hurt a boy, you know, in that so young age.
So there's even the reason why you chose to do it, coming from your mother's justification of hurting men. Yeah. Yep. No, it's all good. Pamela, thank you.
Since 2014, when you had to give me a real sock and say, well, why am I so angry? I thank you very much for that, because it got me out of denial.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to go through the process of I think I am. And I've got, yesterday I sort of felt that my global was...
Can I stop you,
Pam? Sorry.
Both questions.
Yep.
We're off topic.
Oh, off topic.
Please stay on the topic. Okay. It's an act of love to stay on the topic.
Yeah, okay.
Let's go to another... Sorry. Janine, down the front here. Oh, Thalia, I'm just skipping over you all the time.
No,
fire away, girl. Sorry.
It's all good. I just had a question. We'll have a couple if that's okay.
It's on topic, isn't it?
Yes, hopefully.
Awesome. Here I am ignoring you, you're on topic.
Well, I was going to ask, what are some examples of intrinsic qualities of someone's personality? Is that on? Hopefully that's on topic.
Oh, boy, jeez. You could go on for days about that, couldn't you, really? Let you be more self-reflective. How about you be more self-reflective? What are some things that you suspect are a part of your real nature that have generally been condemned or or that you feel embarrassed about, or that you feel like you can't really do that because of your environment.
Oh, just my passionate passions for creating music.
Yeah.
Have been condemned, you know, by my mother and family.
Yeah.
Looked down upon as if that's not a job. You need to get a real job.
Yeah.
You know, you can't do that.
So wanting to live your life producing music.
Yeah.
And instead what's the system that around you saying? They're saying no, yep. Not allowed to do that.
Yeah.
Yep. There's an example. But what about your personality and nature? That's an external thing you can choose to do, like music, to engage a passion, which is a passion inside of yourself. But what about parts of your nature, like inside?
Yeah,
of
I
yourself?
Feel like I'm a bit of a comedian inside.
Okay,
and yeah. I want to be funny, like you know, and I feel like I have to, you know, my jokes aren't funny sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
and you know, you feel possibly a bit embarrassed part of about my that.
Yeah,
and then you
bit
don't
of shame.
Do it.
Yeah, yeah,
feel a bit of shame. Yeah. Yeah.
So I feel like that's a bit of part of my personality is that I've
good, yeah.
got a pretty, you know, I'm pretty funny, I think, sometimes.
Yeah.
That's just one thing. What else?
Can you see that?
Yeah, it's hard.
The question I'm asking you is, yeah, really hard to answer for you.
It is really hard.
Isn't it? And that illustrates how difficult it is to answer for most people, because their real self has been suppressed by this so much, for most of us the real self, like I said, and like I've said in the outline, if you look at the outline from this section and from the last section, you can see that the real self is really almost completely undeveloped at all. So for most of us, we don't know.
Yeah,
we don't know. And the only way you're going to know is by allowing yourself to be more emotional, like more connected and more emotionally connected to your will and what do you really want to do. And also by getting rid of some of this, because getting rid of this is like a great big suppressive blanket over the top of who you are. It's like, in some ways, it's like imagine I'm saying to everybody else, Thalia, come up here. And then I put a blanket over you and I say, now describe Thalia to me.
Yeah.
Right? And everybody look at you and say, it's just a blanket. And that's really what this is like. It's just a blanket over the top of the real you. And anybody who looks at you just sees the blanket. Mm. Right? And when you look in the mirror, all you see is the blanket. And so you don't see yourself. And so my answering the question becomes an endeavor of your own will. It's something that you need to decide to do for yourself. Now, what I notice is that most people want reassurance in the process. So what we do is like I'm encouraging you to discover your real self. Yep. But what you're wanting me to do is to tell you a little bit about your real self. Right? Now, the only problem with that, and it's very dangerous actually what you're doing, because you're asking me, a third party, to describe to you what you are like. Now, the only problem with that is if I'm not loving, if I have all of this blanket on me, can you see that all I'm doing is describing my blanket's interaction with your blanket? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And what's going to be accomplished out of this? Two blankets all messed up, but no real self come out of it, right?
Yeah.
And what we need to do is see that actually the problem with asking another about your real self is that you are not discovering it for yourself, right? And you are only listening to their perception of you, right? And when you do this, you are actually leaving yourself quite open to manipulation and control, and leaving yourself quite open to further damage in this regard by somebody telling you something about yourself that is actually not true, either negative or positive. So I've observed many people do this. It's very common in young people to come up to me and ask me, you know, what do I find special about them? And the very first thing I feel like saying is, why do you need to be special? That's an injury, right? The need to be special is an injury. From God's perspective, all of us are special. So why do I need to be special? It's driven by an injury, an emotional injury inside of myself. So what I'm suggesting to you is, rather than I answer the question, you are far better off going on the journey of self-discovery. Now, what are the things that are impediment to that journey of self-discovery of your real self? Can you see your fear of making mistakes, the fear of experimenting and not finding out something, the fear of wasting time, the fear of being told things about yourself that turn out to be not true, or ignoring things that are true? Like, these are all fears, which are all part of this construction, and they all need to go for you to develop your real self. Now, I said that I'm only 5% of my real self. Now, if I'm only 5% of my real self, is it wise to ask me about your real self?
Definitely not. Probably wiser to ask God, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because God knows your real self, huh? Mm. So it's not very wise to ask somebody who's self-confessed to be only 5% of your real self to tell you about your real self. It is also placing responsibility and reliance on that person, which is also not good for yourself. A lot of times we do it because we're avoiding this fear that we have. If I engage my real self and I engage the discovery of my real self, how much am I going to get hammered? Is really the question we're asking ourselves a lot of the time. And the reality is, the way the world's constructed at the moment, there's a high likelihood you're going to get hammered a bit, because they don't want you to be your real self. They're confronted by your real self. The irony is, though, that people who love you will love you discovering your real self. And they will want you to, they'll encourage you to discover your real self. But they won't take responsibility for doing it. They won't tell you about your real self. Does that make sense? Mm. So usually when I meet people, I can feel from them a fair bit, obviously. And because the more you feel from yourself, the more you can feel from other people. So you can feel a fair bit from them, and I usually can also feel what their underlying goals and their big picture goals are, you know, things they've not even considered yet, what they'll be doing in the long term in their life, whether it's now on earth or in the spirit world, it really doesn't matter. But it's rare for me to tell anybody what that is, because it's actually dangerous for me to do so. Because then you could choose to actually do those things without it being a feeling that you want to inside of your heart, and just because somebody who you respect has told you. Yeah. So engage the process of self-discovery, Thalia.
Yep.
Yep. Cool. Now, you've got little smidgens of it already. You know, the music, that's definitely one area where you've been squashed. So what you do instead now is you do what you can do there. You do things. You engage a plan. You engage your life now trying to produce what people have told you can't do.
Yeah.
Like this whole concept that you can't make a living from music is a really a weird concept, considering that there's many people on the planet who do make a living from music.
Yeah.
So it tells you that, you know, you can even make a living from doing what you desire from your heart to do. But the reality is, each one of us does have a uniqueness as a part of one of God's gifts to us about our personality. Mm. And like to me, each person I meet, once they connect to their real selves, you sort of see a little spark of God's nature. It educates you about God's nature as well. And that's part of the reason why God put part of God's nature and personality inside of each individual differently, so that we could all get educated about God's nature. And it's really weird in the spirit world what happens too. You can be in a place in the spirit world where there's millions of people, and then all of a sudden you feel slightly different. And you know what that is? It's a new person entering that sphere who wasn't there before. Hmm. It's described in the Robert James Lee's books, remember? Yeah. And that's how it feels. It's like a new person who wasn't in that sphere before has now just entered that sphere. And you can actually feel along with their, you can feel their nature and personality change the sphere itself. Do you know what I mean? So when the first person entered the sphere, so when I entered the seventh sphere, it was pretty boring. It was just my personality. And then the next person enters the sphere, and the next person enters the sphere. It changes the sphere changes the location, and it becomes a blend of the personalities in that state. So the key is for you to engage your personality and your nature, and to do so without restriction. And of course, the only restriction you'd place on it is the question of, am I being loving from God's perspective or not? Mm-hmm. That's my only question. So yeah, I feel we could list a whole heap of things that are part of personality or and nature, or we can say, no, it's far better for me to say to you, go on a discovery voyage.
Yeah, definitely.
So go on a voyage of discovery and learn to love that voyage of discovery. Mm. And you'll learn to love yourself as a part of that process.
Yeah.
And your own uniqueness. Mm.
Cool. All right, thank you. Mm. And I just had a second question.
Go ahead.
You mentioned that the real self can be developed alongside,
yep,
while you're dealing with all of the other stuff. And I just wanted to know what that kind of looks like.
Well, what did we say this was? The primary terror that we have is to be our real self. Right, so obviously I'm going to have to deal with that terror before I'm going to allow myself to discover my real self, don't I? Mm. But assuming that I've done some of that, or a little bit of that even, then what I need to do is honour my real self all the time, honour who I really am all the time. Mm. And I notice you don't. Most people don't do that. They don't honour who they are. So tomorrow we're going to talk more about that, what it means to honour who you are and take action based upon who you are. And a part of being your real self is to experience yourself emotionally, mm-hmm, and to just be emotional and in your experience with every person you know. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And then they get to see who you are. And that's what I'd classify as sharing yourself. Mm-hmm. And most of us are terrified of that. We need to get through the terror of doing that. Right. Now, I notice that in the four primary areas, and particularly in the area of truth. Mm-hmm. Most of you, whenever truth is confronted, that's where most of you no longer yourselves. You don't say the truth. You're not transparent about what you feel. You're not honest about the fact that you have this problem or that problem. Mm-hmm. You try to tone down different issues. Well, none of that's being yourself as you are right now. We've got to learn to be ourselves as we are right now, right? And that means addressing some of this terror. In fact, to do that, you have to feel some of this.
Yep. So it's a bit like you were talking about before, aspiring to develop faith, you would experiment with speaking in truth all the time or...
Not just that. You would see it as a prerequisite to you becoming yourself.
Sure. Yeah.
So you're not going to become yourself unless you speak the truth all the time.
Yeah.
You're not going to become yourself unless you feel your emotion all the time. You're not going to become yourself unless you take action about what you feel. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You're not going to become yourself unless you do these things. So stop expecting other people to like who you are, and just be who you are. And the people who love you will definitely like who you are.
Yeah.
And the people who don't love you will have their own reasons for not loving you. And it won't be anything to do with you, in fact.
Yeah.
Because the reality is they are capable of loving everybody. Mm. And that means they're also capable of loving you. And if they choose to not love you, that is their choice.
Yeah.
So we need to give up this concept that we can earn people's love and respect.
Yeah.
You follow?
That's a big one for me.
Yeah. Need to give that up and actually just go ahead, do exactly what you know is in harmony with love. If you don't know it's in harmony with love, then question it. Don't act upon it. Question it. Write it down as an option. You know, this is an option, but I still don't know if it's harmonious with love or not. But all the things that you know that are harmonious with love, you act upon them and you do them.
Yeah.
And in that process, you will discover your nature, who you feel yourself to be. And you let yourself be your nature as well, which is wonderful. Because other people then don't have to work to experience you.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah. Right. Now, if I was up here in front of you, all just real toned down, and you've got a question, you know, I might know a whole heap of things, but you've got to ask me a question about everything. Right? Yep. Then you'd be having to do a whole heap of work to even know me, wouldn't you? Yeah. Can you see how unloving that would be of me? To make you work to know me, right? And to make you work to know the truth. Yeah. That would be unloving, very unloving, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
It's far better if I just say, so somebody says to me, somebody asked me about my, I think it was Alan, wasn't it, about my worth or something. I say, yeah, my worth's terrible. You know what I mean? Yeah. 5% of what I need to be there. Mm. That's the truth. I feel it's the truth. And you know, I can talk about that freely because I don't feel like, well, you want to judge me about that? Well, that's your unloving behavior, not mine. Mm. All I'm trying to do is work through it. So, you see?
Yeah.
Let yourself be yourself. If you don't know what that is, then do as many things as you can to learn about what that is.
Yeah.
So you do some art, you do some, you know, you do a whole heap of external things, and in the process you'll discover your nature, your personality.
Yeah.
So it's not about even doing those things specifically. It's about while you're doing them, how do you feel? And it's your feelings that end up determining your nature and your personality. Mm. Can you see that? It's not what you do. So when you say you're interested in music, that tells me, like, that doesn't tell me anything about your nature. Because I love music too.
Yeah, that's true.
All right?
Yeah. And so, a lot of people love it.
So. And most people love it. Yeah. So that doesn't tell me your unique about unique personality and nature. Mm. How do you feel when you're doing music? Mm. That tells me more about your personality and nature. Mm. Now, some people feel joy and other people feel mass and other people feel also there's all sorts of feelings that people have doing music. Very different feelings while they're doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the feelings that a person has shows me their nature or their personality. So it's what you feel about what you do.
Cool. Yeah.
More than what you do. Mm. Do you follow?
Yeah.
That is an expression of your nature.
Yeah. Mm. Cool. Thank you.
No worries. If we go to Rick up the back. Oh, sorry, we're at Jeanine first. All right.
I've got two questions.
Fire away.
How can we best use God's playground to learn? What things can we do to learn more about God and ourselves?
So let's go to the first question, then you'll have to remind me about the second.
That's part of the first question.
Okay, well, you have to remind me about the second half of the first question. Right, so the first part of the question was just one at a time.
How can we best use God's playground to learn?
Okay, God's playground is all about experimenting. Can you see that? So the key is to do as many experiments as you can every single day about all sorts of aspects of your life, some of them physical, some of them emotional, some of them spiritual, to do with love. So you do as many things as you can in a day, experimenting with as many new things that you can every day. So that requires a bit of forethought, doesn't it? Like to think about the next day and what am I going to experiment with the next day? What am I experimenting with now? You know, my primary experimentation myself, from an emotional perspective for myself, is about my worth. Then I've got experiments happening with regard to spirits, and then I've got some experiments happening at home with regard to my physical environment in terms of watching what I do and how love can be expressed in my physical environment, measuring the results of those. So the key is to experiment and then measure the results of the experiments. And to me, that's what if you think of a little child playing in a sandpit, isn't that what it's doing a lot of the time? So it picks up the sand. One experiment's a good experiment. So it eats that, spits it out, you know. But it's just had an experiment. It knows that sand doesn't taste as good as a, you know, piece of fruit or something. Right? Just from that experiment. A parent would go, don't eat that. But the child has yet to experiment to see whether that is worth eating or not. Right? One time when I was a child, apparently I ate all my poo. I'm pretty sure I didn't go for that experiment afterwards. But anyway, I'm pretty sure I haven't done it since. But anyway, but that just... gives you an idea of what you do as a child. Is you're not afraid of all that, are you? You just experiment. One of my sons was funny. He used to experiment with putting things in holes all the time. And we'd have blocked drains and blocked everything, you know, nothing would. But that's his experiment. So he wanted to see what the results of it were, you know. No matter how frustrating it was, he'd sometimes block the whole street, you know, like, so it's like, so it goes. That's his experiment. He learnt that in time, you know. So the key is to encourage your own experimentation in harmony with love, and then to measure the results of it, and to not get so hung up on sort of having to know everything in up front. Yeah. Now, I can think of hundreds of different experiments that any person who enjoys life would probably want to try, you know. And the key is to experiment in all the aspects of your life, physically, emotionally, spiritually, with love. You experiment with all things. Of course, your experiments in love are the most important. They're the things that are going to teach you the most. And your experiments with God in particular are going to be the very most important. They're the things that you're going to benefit you the most. But you can choose. God's saying to you, well, you don't have to experiment with God. You could just experiment with your own self if you want. But the key is to experiment as many areas of your life as you possibly can at the same time. Does that make sense?
Yep.
So that's what I would do. And don't forget to measure the results. Yeah, don't forget to measure the results. The results are what establishes a faith, and it also establishes your knowledge. It establishes truth and error. So you definitely want to measure the results, not to forget doing that. Yeah. So the second part of your first question.
I think you've answered it. What things can we do to learn more about God and ourselves?
Yeah,
I think you've answered it.
Yeah. It's the same thing, just do, again, experiments with God. What are you going to do? Experiment. What experiments are you going to come up with? That's up to you. And how are you going to measure? That's also something that you need to determine. But it's always good to do that. That's basically, I sort of approach life. Well, it's strange because it's not like a scientist today would express, because a lot of scientists today are very rigid and like, you know, they measure meticulously everything and they do everything meticulously, which I think is a good thing, and I do that. But they're pretty rigid emotionally about the whole experience, I suppose you could say. And the key with your experimentations is to never be rigid emotionally about them. Does that make sense? Because remember, emotions are your soul. So if you engage experiments from an emotional perspective, you're going to have far better results than if you just rigidly do it from an intellectual place. Yep. So engage desire, engage emotion in the process. Yep.
Okay.
Good. Second question.
Okay. You've talked a bit about this. I did this last night, so I've worded it twice.
Yeah, yeah.
What have you done to develop your personality and nature? And also, what can we do to develop our personality and nature?
For myself, very little. I've done very little in this because like I said, I've only got 5% of my personality and nature. So you know, this is where having a poor sense of self-worth is certainly has a large impact on the expression of your nature and personality. So I need to do more. I've been attempting to do more in that regard. But to give you some examples, the different kinds of things that I've chosen to do with personality and nature is, firstly, everywhere where my family doesn't like my nature, I have purposely tried to experiment in those areas. So to me that makes sense to do because whatever they don't like is probably stuff that they've controlled in me from doing, you see what I'm saying? So all the things they don't like are firstly what I've tried to engage. So kind of things there are speaking the truth under all circumstances in any situation, like they hate that. So I need to do that to just see what it's really like, to measure the results of that. I've had to do a lot of experiments, of course, to accept my identity. A huge amount of experiments there to accept who I am. And that's all about allowing myself to remember things, allowing myself to feel about my memories of those things and so forth. So that's like remembering, for you, that'd be like remembering childhood events and allowing yourself to feel about what you felt about those events. Right? Did you feel enthusiastic or did you feel depressed about it? Or did you feel like you'd really like to find out more about that and it got squashed? Or did you feel like you weren't interested in that? And I'd look at both areas, where anything you wasn't interested in and anything you felt enthusiastic about. Usually there's stuff in both directions there. Another thing that I've done is I've looked at what people would say to me about what they don't like about me and frequently purposely attempt to do those things just to see whether I like them about me or not.
That's good.
Does that make sense? So in a conversation I'm quite outspoken, particularly what people will notice is I'm quiet in conversations. Until issues of truth come up or issues of love come up, then I'm outspoken. So other than that, quite reserved. In fact, I've had conversation with some people where I haven't said a word for 6 hours in a conversation. I just listen to them and listen and listen and whatever. Because I've done that because there was really not much I could say. They weren't open to hearing any truth. They told me they didn't want to. And I'm okay sitting down listening to them if I'm with them and there's nothing else to do. Probably prefer there was something else to do. But I'm okay with that. You know, I don't have to talk if under those circumstances. So I don't. But if I don't want to hear what a conversation's all about and I don't want to get involved, I'll just tell them that. I don't like that conversation. I'd rather talk about something else. And if you don't want to talk about something else, I'll get going. Of course, not many people like that because they want, in their addiction, they want you to, you see. But these are all parts of you discovering you. Doing what seems to be not the norm and measure the results of it. Like, how much of this is really bad and how much of it is just a person's opinion? Like, I think the reality is, like, I listen to people of all sorts of personalities and opinions, and even a lot of opinions that are expressed to me that are completely out of harmony with love or truth, I still listen to them. So if someone has a difficulty listening to my opinions, which are more harmonious with love and truth, I feel, well that's their decision and not mine. You know, that's not my fault that they have that difficulty. So I don't blame myself for the difficulties other people have hearing me or engaging me. In the past I have a lot, but that's one of the things I'm experimenting with, not doing that. So allow yourself to sort of examine yourself more carefully, but also be yourself more without editing, you know, without that thing going on where you go, is this all right for public consumption or not, type of thing. Will this be misunderstood? Will this be, you know, we have all that going on all the time, you know, and these are all the, you could say it comes from our pain, but it's all the things we do in our facade to avoid acknowledgement of our real self and how we really feel. So the key is to acknowledge how you really feel about the situation. So some conversations just bore me to death. They do. You know? Someone comes up and starts talking about, you know, the weather, the dog the other day that was down the street and what happened with it. And I just...
Same.
So what if you loved them and you loved yourself and you were experimenting, what would you do? You say, this conversation bores me to tears. Can we talk about something else? Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you do that?
Haven't done that.
No, but... I doubt with many of you have, because if you love the truth, that's what you'll probably do. You just it just pours me tears. See the tears? And you would want to, you know, you don't want to waste your time anymore. How many times you sit down in conversations for a half an hour and you walk away thinking, what was that? That was just a waste of a half an hour. Why did I do that for?
Right? I think, when is it going to get real?
Well, it's going to get real when you get real.
When I get real.
Yeah, that's what I've learned. It's going to get real when I get real. It gets real pretty quick. If I get real, gets real immediately. Straight after I've got real. It's wonderful. It doesn't mean that everyone likes you, but everything is real. Everything is a real interaction. And people start to feel your nature and personality. Yeah, some of them won't like it because they have all heap of judgments about that kind of nature or personality. Does that make sense? But I don't judge your nature and personality. I'm okay with you, you know, being outspoken and saying what you think and, you know, crying when you need to cry and laughing when you laugh and feeling happy when you're happy and feeling sad when you're sad. I'm okay with all that. So if someone's not all okay with that with me, it's not my problem. It's their problem. Right? So I recognize what is their problem in love and what's mine through that interaction. Experiment with all these things.
Thank you. That's really good.
God's given you all these gifts, right? God's given you your will. Act upon it. God's giving you the truth. So act upon it. God's saying to you, have some faith in my goodness. So act like God's good. And I also feel like other people are good. Like, stop assuming everyone's bad. And people will show you sooner or later. And if once you become more sensitive emotionally, you'll feel, no, that person is bad. That person's got bad intention. They just want to hurt people. And so you won't spend much time with them. You won't want to. And you'll tell them that when they come up. Say, look, the reason why I don't spend any time with you is because I can feel your bad motivations. You know, the motivations of manipulation or control, or you're trying to shut a person down, or you're trying to make yourself feel superior to the person or whatever. And I don't like that. I don't even like that. I don't like that done to me, but I don't like it done to my friends either. So I can't spend much time with you while you do that type of thing. Be honest, you know, about God's giving you the tools, the gifts of your will, the laws, everything. The key is to use them to discover yourself.
Thank you.
Make sense? Yeah. If we go back to Yvonne, straight behind.
Thanks. Under universal laws, mm-hmm. What's an example of laws that only have positive consequences?
Law of repentance.
Isn't that one, though, that I'm... Oh.
Well, you tell me it's negative consequences.
No. Yeah, that's true.
Doesn't it only have a positive one?
Oh, I was putting them under the some of these laws must be consciously engaged by the soul.
That one has to be consciously engaged by the soul?
Right. But it's true that it does only have positive consequences.
And it does only have positive consequences. Okay. Law of forgiveness, same thing.
Yep.
Law of desire.
Yep.
That one has positive and negative consequences.
Yes.
Because I could exercise my desire out of harmony of love and, whoa, I'm going to get a whole heap of negative consequences from that, right? But there's other laws that only have positive consequences, like law of divine love, how divine love flows in the soul. You open your heart to the Holy Spirit, bang. Mm. Only positive consequences.
Again, but
to me, crying is not a negative consequence.
No, but they also have to be... consciously engaged by the soul.
They have to be consciously engaged by the soul, and crying is not a negative consequence. Feeling an emotion is not a negative consequence. In my mind, feeling an emotion is a great thing. It feels good to feel emotion. So, yeah, crying is not a negative consequence of any. So engaging the law of repentance, only positive results.
I thought you were going to tell me something fancy like interstellar galactic instant travel or something.
Well, there's that as well. Like, you know, once you know how to teleport, do you think it's going to be negative? Of course it's not. Once you know how to fly, well, you know, that could have negative or positive consequences, depending on what you hit. Couldn't it? Just depends how you use it. Like, if you decide to, you know, you can fly now and you decide, I'm going to jump off this cliff and I'm going to fly, but I'm going to see how close to the trees I can get while I do it. and you make a little mistake, what might happen is one might go through you. So that would be a negative consequence. So some will have positive and negative consequences, of course, depending on your skills at engaging them as well. So you learn this, you learn to look after yourself in the process of discovering these laws. So yeah, there's many physical laws that have positive consequences. Like gravity is one, isn't it? Positive consequence plus a negative consequence if you break it. Yep. Yep. But then there's other laws like, you know, like most of the physical laws have positive and negative consequences. So aerodynamics, positive consequence, you can fly. Negative consequence, if you stop flying, you could have a problem. Yeah. So, you know, some of the laws have both. Of course, a lot of the laws have both. But the soul-based laws, most of them, you know, the law of compensation is the only soul-based law that actually has negative compensation as well as positive compensation. All the other soul-based laws, the ones that are specifically designed for the soul itself, only have positive effects on the soul. Mm. Mm. Good question. Jada.
I was wondering if God's always, God's laws are trying to bring us awareness all the time,
mm-hmm.
and that's a very powerful thing,
mm-hmm.
and we're trying to stay in denial, are we using some of our true nature and our gifts that are quite powerful in that process?
Well, you could say we're using the gift of free will in a negative way, aren't we? By trying to stay in denial of something, we are using the gift of free will, but it's exercised in an unloving manner towards ourselves. Because denial, obviously, if we had truth, we would know more and therefore be able to experience more and therefore understand more and so forth. And this is all going to be good for us. So the fact that we're in denial, using our will to deny, means that probably the consequences are going to be bad for us. And even one negative consequence is just not knowing the truth. That's also a negative consequence. So many of us go around this world now and we say, oh, that truth can't be proven, this truth can't be proven, that truth can't. So we live in a state of doubt of everything. And that's a negative consequence of not engaging faith, and negative consequence of not discovering what the truth actually is, using our will to discover it. So we end up making a lot of choices and decisions based on ignorance, and then those choices and decisions based on ignorance hurt us. The consequence of them hurt us. And we, in some ways, we can really only blame ourselves for that, because if we had discovered the truth, then we could have used it. So I sort of see laws like, you know, you got a mobile phone, right?
Yep.
Yep. Pretty handy device.
Yep.
Yeah. You can be anywhere, almost anywhere in the world, given a few limitations, mm-hmm. and talk to another person anywhere in the world who has another device the same. Amazing.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Now that particular device came about because somebody discovered like hundreds of laws. When I say hundreds of laws, I'm talking there's laws regarding the transmission of signals in a vacuum and transmission of signals in a atmosphere. There's laws governing sort of electronics and how electrical signals flow, voltages, potential differences, voltages, currents, and so forth. There's laws involving eyesight with regard to the LCD display, how everything gets displayed. There's a whole heap of laws involved in that. So you could say that it's taken possibly 100 laws to build a mobile phone, the discovery of 100 laws to build a mobile phone. Now, hasn't it been of benefit?
Yeah.
So why wouldn't the discovery of other laws be of benefit? They would be, wouldn't they, every time? So can you see every time we sort of deny ourselves from discovering law, we're really placing a self-imposed limitation on us, on ourselves. See, to me, that doesn't make any sense. That's like saying, oh, we could have made a mobile phone, but we decided not to. And we decided to remain in the dark ages 100 years ago, where you could, or 200 years ago, where there was no phone at all. We decided to remain there instead. Now, that doesn't make much sense to me. On a physical level, it certainly doesn't make any sense. If you know how to improve your life and yet you choose to not do it, then it doesn't make much sense, does it?
No.
So the same applies to the spiritual laws, to the love-based laws. If you know that you could, if you think about it this way, any time you've discovered a physical law, you've been able to use it to your benefit. That's true, isn't it?
Yeah.
Every physical law you've ever been able to discover or somebody else has discovered has always been used to your benefit. Right. Of course, people have also used it in other ways, harmful ways, but the majority of them turn out to be beneficial to humankind. If that's the case with physical laws, why would that not be more the case with spiritual laws and soul-based laws? So, for example, if I give an example, if I knew the laws that involved and the emotions that were involved in creating cancer, then that means I not only could I cure myself of cancer, but I could cure every single person of cancer who has ever had it, engaging those same laws, by engaging those laws. Now, isn't that beneficial?
Yeah.
Why wouldn't you want to do that?
Yeah.
It doesn't make any sense not to do it, does it? It alleviates pain. It gets rid of a whole heap of problems on the planet. We don't need medications anymore. We don't need to have these terrible procedures where we half die while we're trying to live. None of those things would happen anymore. Isn't that, that'd be wonderful. Makes sense that I do that. And what I'm suggesting is that engaging any of God's laws only makes sense. It's only the most logical thing to do. Yeah.
Yeah. The part I was thinking was like the, just say an innate part of myself, my true self.
Mm-hmm.
Am I sometimes using that to stay in denial?
Would your true self, your real self, ever want to be in denial?
No.
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 So the only motivation for being in denial is fear, isn't it? Like you're afraid of something. Mm. And if you're afraid of something, doesn't that fit into this structure here? It does, doesn't it?
Mm.
So the reality is every time you engage denial, every time you want to shut yourself down from knowing something, that's not your real self now being engaged because it makes no sense. Like when you were a child, when you were a little child, wasn't it investigation after investigation after investigation with no limitation until somebody else came along, somebody else, parent sin, came along and imposed the limitation. That's the only time you stopped investigating. So what I'm suggesting to you is that part of the design, the instinctual design of your real self is the desire to investigate. Does that make sense? Yep. And if that's not happening, then it's because of an injury, a pain-based injury or a facade-based injury.
Mm.
Yep. And if you think about it, one of those injuries causes us then to believe that ignorance is good. A lot of you feel that. It's better if I don't know. Like, many of you think you'd rather know who your soulmate is, but the reality is that's not what I feel from you. What I feel from you is that you'd rather not know. And that way you can choose wherever you want, or that way you don't have to confront the fact that they might be not who you want or like, or at the moment, you know. You choose to not know. You choose ignorance, thinking that ignorance will somehow benefit you. But it never does. It's never going to. Ignorance is always going to have a penalty associated with it. And that is, if you don't know, you can't do anything about something. Yeah. Yep. And all of that, it comes from pain. It all comes from terror and pain. Mm. So your real self, Jada, wants to know.
Yep.
Okay. Or if it doesn't want to know, it certainly doesn't not want to know. Do you understand what I mean by that?
Not really.
No, let me explain. So here's your real self, right? The real self has been designed so that it doesn't matter to it that it knows or not knows, but has been designed also with a longing inside of it to know, right? So the real self has a desire to know. In addition to that, the real self doesn't not want to know. So in other words, it doesn't have a refusal to knowing. Do you follow me? So in other words, it's neutral. It's either desire to know or it's neutral about knowing. In other words, there's no emotional impediment to it knowing. It's the pain that causes us to no longer be neutral and decide to reject knowledge. Do you follow that? So the real self doesn't desire to reject knowledge by default. The real self has a desire to know by default and also may not know, so therefore it does have, but it has no impediment to knowing. It wants to know, or it's okay with knowing. It's neutral about knowing. Does that make sense? It's neutral. How to spell neutral? N-E-U. Whenever we have a negative force saying, I don't want to know, that's driven by pain or fear. Right? So that's not a part of our real self. That's something we have, fear or a pain causing us to not want to know. Because the reality is, and again, if you think about it from a physical level, physically we do want to discover more of God's laws. We do. You know, we've spent, a lot of scientists spend every single moment of their living life wanting to discover more of God's laws, wanting to discover how things work physically. So they want to know. They want to know because they know the benefits that come from knowing, right? And the reality is, if we understood that ourselves, we would always see knowing as a positive thing rather than a negative one. In other words, we would love truth. We would love to know. We would not like being ignorant, right? When we like being ignorant, and when we like to deny, and when we like to not know, that's because of fear and pain that we have within us. It's always good to find out those places because there's always some pain associated with it. So to give you an example of that with my worth, for a long period of time, I didn't want to know. And one of the main motivations I had for that was that I felt that the pain would be too extreme. But now I see all the disadvantages of not knowing, of not having more worth. Does that make sense? Mm. And now that I feel the disadvantages of it, I go, hang on a sec, that's stupid. That's a stupid decision. Yeah. I need to know what's causing my lack of worth. I need to feel it so that I can get to a stage where I feel like I'm worth something. And that's going to have, I can see already, big benefits that's going to have in my life and yours too. If I can model to every one of you what it's like to have worth, surely that's going to help you too.
Actually, I had a question about that. Yep. Worth. The nature of having low worth, is that always going to probably be the last emotion you deal with?
I don't know. Possibly. I've thought about that a fair bit, obviously, in addressing the emotion. Mm. And I feel that, yeah, it's probably one of those emotions that most of us have a fair large degree of pain associated with, so therefore probably one of the last emotions we'll address. Yeah. Mm. And in the first century, I didn't see anyone address it. You know, like, it was a big problem for everyone. And it was really weird in the first century not having it, living in a world where everyone has it, you know. So at least I have a memory of what that's like. That's going to help me as well work through the emotion, I feel. But having a memory of what it's like to not have a problem with worth is helpful, because it helps you see all the advantages of not having that problem, you know. Yeah. Yeah. But it is a big problem on the planet, huge problem on the planet. Yeah. So therefore, it's going to be one of the most difficult emotions for me to work through. Yep.
Mm. Thank you.
Yep. Okay, if we go, Pamela.
So tied in with what you've just been speaking about with worth,
mm-hmm.
It would seem then that self-forgiveness is important or not? Is that a delusional...
Hey, I don't know about this self-forgiveness thing. To me, it feels more like repentance.
Mm-hmm.
Repentance for treating myself badly.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, rather than forgiveness.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you speak a bit, can you expand on that a bit more?
Well, it's off topic now.
Okay, just so, yeah. All right.
So, yep. Sess, thank you.
Jesus, I'm looking at the part about degradation.
Yep.
And where it says degradation is limited and finite.
Yep.
The more pain I feel, the higher the likelihood of stopping. I'm experiencing some of that, I feel.
Yep.
The more pain I feel, the less power I have to sin.
Yes.
So I understand that being the case in the spirit world. Where
it's also the case here.
And could you explain more about how it's the case here?
Really obvious. So the more pain you get in physically, how much mobility do you have?
Oh, I see. Yeah, had not thought of the extremes of that.
Yeah. So the more pain you get in physically, the less mobility you have. Therefore, you have a restriction on sinning. You see, you can't sin as much as you did before because you now can't spend more time with more people. You spend time with less people. You're more bedridden. Eventually, you might get to be bedridden. You can't move at all.
Oh, gee, I was thinking I'd gotten near the extreme. Yeah. But I can see how this.
Yeah. So the extreme of sinning in our day-to-day life on earth is that eventually we get to the stage where we're bedridden and we die. So we're definitely limited in our scope to actually commit more sin. And then we pass into the spirit world and we don't think our sin has ceased yet, and so we continue now. We've now got a bit more freedom, so we sin a bit more, but there's more pain, and eventually you get so much pain there that you're almost bedridden there too. Does that make sense? And people have done that. People get to the stage where they're totally unable to move. Remember an example of that was a man that I spoke to. I forget his name. He was the man who was following the groups around trying to get different ones of you to do a whole heap of unloving things. Is it Anthony was his name? Yeah, remember I took him to a guy who had done that all of his life in the spirit world for some period of time. And what was that guy like now? He was, if you could picture it in your mind, he was going like that, around in circles. So was he hurting anybody now?
Couldn't affect anybody now
because he'd gone bonkers affecting people, right? And that's the result of his sin. That's the direct result of his sin. So the reality is we can get ourselves into a place where we're completely confined spiritually and emotionally and also on earth physically confined to not hurt anybody anymore.
Why is it that when you describe people who've been in the hells for I think even hundreds of thousands of years.
Well, there's very few that have ever been there that long, but yeah.
Mm. But so is it just
what's the question though, Seth?
About the tolerance of pain. Because I understand God's created the universe to bring
when
to
you say
redeem
the tolerance,
us.
When you say the tolerance of pain, what do you mean?
Well, if God's created the universe
to redeem us,
mm-hmm. then, and so far, as you described, the pain of people in the bottom of the hells is so extreme you can't imagine it getting more.
Yep.
I'm just wondering.
Doesn't that show you how conditioned we are to using our will to avoid pain? That we're willing to get into extreme conditions and still attempt to avoid our pain. And this is, for many of you, that's what it's been like in your life. You're willing to get yourself into terrible, terrible place just so that you can avoid pain. Mm. So it's really a statement, isn't it, about man's use of their will in a negative direction. See, most of you don't realize, it's sort of like the pain, you avoiding pain causes huge damage to yourself and others. It does. So God's given you all these gifts, right, to help you grow, but he's also given you this feedback gift, which is pain, the pain that is associated with degradation. So if you're in pain, see, remember right back at the first, in the first presentations we did, this is a couple of months ago now, in the first group, I talked about the pain pleasure thing. Remember that? The reason why I raised that issue with you is because the majority of us are only driven by the avoidance of pain. But the problem is, all that does is create more pain. And eventually the pain goes to such incredible heights that we stop and pause. We stop doing the thing that creates more pain eventually. Now, my suggestion is become sensitive to it now, so you stop now, rather than waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting until, you know, you're really in extreme amounts of pain. And if you believe that being bedridden on earth is the most pain that you can be in, well, that's not true. There's plenty of people in the spirit world in far more pain than that. So don't believe that, you know, avoidance of pain is your biggest problem, without a doubt. Avoidance of this pain, the fear of pain, is the biggest problem we face as humanity. Right? It causes huge amounts of damage to your life. It means that you reject most of God's gifts. You also reject most of yourself. You also can't connect to your real self. You also are going to experience terrible, terrible results of sinning and sinning and sinning again just to avoid pain, right? And it's all very self-destructive. One of the best things you could choose to do for your entire life is to choose to feel emotional pain rather than avoid it. Just really simple. Just that one thing.
Thank you.
Yeah. And do that one thing, whole things in your life change, but also you're no longer creating more sin. The avoidance of pain creates more sin every time. So avoiding pain is not a good choice. We need to learn that it's not a good choice. Humanity collectively needs to learn it's not a good choice.
Can I ask one thing?
We're over time by 5 minutes, so I need to probably stop now. All right, so that's been our day today. Thank you for your participation today. Pretty open today. Inquisitive. Good to see some of that inquisitiveness coming out. Sorry, I haven't got the time to answer all the questions because we've got more information to present, but don't lose that inquisitive about this inquisitiveness about these subjects. Allow yourself to develop it more. Write down your questions, send them in. We'll categorize them under the topic. And when you do send in your questions, put it under the topic of the discussion that you thought it relates to. We might change some of it, but put it under the topic, and we will try to answer those questions at a later time, hopefully during the following year, so that we can address a lot of your questions on these subjects. So one more day tomorrow, guys. Last day. Yep. It's gone slow like a dragging. No. Gone pretty quick. Sometimes it's hard to remember what we did, isn't it? Sometimes, because, and that, you know, this is why it's good to have them recorded.